morning, welcome to our worship at home for today, Sunday the 10th of May. And this is the fifth Sunday of the Easter season. I hope you're all well and keeping in good spirits. We'll begin with our opening prayer. Jesus said, I am the way. He is the light that shines on us and through us. We come to seek the way that we may have new life and serve in all that we are. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And the collect for today. Loving and eternal God, through the resurrection of your Son, help us to face the future with courage and assurance, knowing that nothing in life or death can ever part us from your love for us in Jesus Christ, our Saviour, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's sing together from Singing the Faith, number 252, Jesus the Lord said, I am the bread.
Jesus the Lord said, I am the bread of life.
Let us join in prayer together, our prayers of praise and thanksgiving led by Ella and Izzy.
Let us pray together. Wondrous God, we are blessed that we can come together to praise you. Despite all the restrictions and difficulties in our lives, we come together to worship you and give thanks. We celebrate our life together as your people. In a moment of silence, we share with you all the things we want to give praise and thanks for today. I'd like to give thanks for all the NHS and key workers.
I would like to give thanks for all of the sunny days that we have.
Amen.
And now our prayer of confession. Forgive us, loving God, when we do not accept the diversity of the world, when we forget that we are all your people, loved equally and known to you by name. Forgive us for our foolishness and our thoughtless use of the gifts of your creation. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. For our neglect of you and our failure to care for others, Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. For our selfishness in prayer and our carelessness in worship, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Here is good news for all who put their trust in Christ. Jesus says, your sins are forgiven. Amen. Thanks be to God.
The reading is from the first letter of Peter, chapter 2, verses 2 to 10. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And, like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, see, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you might proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvellous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Thanks be to God for his word.
Now let's hear our gospel reading for this morning from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verses 1 to 14, read by David Bennett.
Reading from John chapter 14. Do not be worried and upset, Jesus told them. Believe in God and believe also in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I am going to prepare a place for you. I would not tell you this if it were not so. And after I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself, so that you will be where I am. You know the way that leads to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way to get there? Jesus answered him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except by me. Now that you have known me, he said to them, you will know my Father also. And from now on, you do know him, and you have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, that is all we need. Jesus answered, for a long time I have been with you all, yet you do not know me, Philip. Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. Why then do you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe, Philip, that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I have spoken to you, Jesus said to his disciples, do not come from me. The Father who remains in me does his own work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. If not, believe because of the things I do. I am telling you the truth. Those who believe in me will do what I do. Yes, they will do even greater things, because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask for in my name, so that the Father's glory will be shown through the Son. If you ask me for anything in my name, I will do it.
In this period of the church year, as we continue to read the book of Acts, we hear the continuing story of the beginnings of the early church, the Acts of the first apostles and the growing community of believers. We know that the disciples saw the living Jesus ascend into heaven to be with the Father, and then waited until the Holy Spirit had come upon them at what we know as Pentecost. And from that moment, they went out, fired up, to proclaim the message of Jesus wherever they went. Last week's set passage from Acts 2:42-47 told us about this growing community of believers and how they developed and practiced the holy habits of the church as they worked out what it meant to be a Christian post-resurrection. How they had to think about again about how they worshipped God, but also how to meet together as fellow Christians, listening to the teachings of the disciples, breaking bread together, sharing with glad and generous hearts, selling their possessions so that they could distribute the proceeds and hold all things in common. But as was the beginning of anything new, they soon ran into trouble. Those who had opposed Jesus hadn't gone away. Peter and John faced opposition and arrest, and Stephen was stoned to death. Here today in the UK, we're not persecuted as Christians as those early Christians were. But we are facing our own troubles. It might be what we might describe it as a wilderness experience that we're in at the moment, because we're not able to meet in our church buildings, our spiritual home, to learn about God, to worship him. And this might lead to us feeling a little bit lost. Perhaps we feel that we're wandering like the Israelites in the book of Exodus. Or perhaps like Jesus when he was alone in the wilderness, facing all kinds of temptation. Except our wandering is confined to our homes, wandering between the dining room and the kitchen, or the bathroom and the study. So here are two images from our readings today that I want to share with you. And the first comes from the New Testament letter, first letter of Peter, chapter 2. The writer urges Jesus' followers to come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, a royal priesthood. I think we're reminded here that though our church buildings might be built of stone and brick, the stones that are important to God are the living stones. Jesus Christ is the living stone who was rejected by people, although precious in God's sight. He's the cornerstone, if you like, the foundation stone, the stone that is the reference point for all the other stones that are put in to build the building. The entire structure depends on him. And we, like living stones, are built into a spiritual house. It's described as a royal priesthood in this passage. And it's us, the church, as a house of living stones, which belongs to God and is where the Holy Spirit is to be found. In us, not in bricks and stones and mortar. Our buildings will still be there, and that meeting together is important for for our communion together and with Christ, and for mutual fellowship and learning and support. But for now, the church resides where we are, its living stones. When we think of a priesthood, it's the priest who makes the sacrifices to God on behalf of his people in the temple of the Old Testament. But if we are all to be part of this royal priesthood, then what are the sacrifices through Jesus that we should make? Well, it is to live a life of holy obedience, following the example of Jesus, doing good in the eyes of God, a life of worship and witness in the service of God. And then the second image that I want to share with you briefly is from John's Gospel 14 and 1 to 14. Jesus tells his followers that there is a place with him prepared for them. He says that in his Father's house there are many rooms. I don't know about you, but it conjures up in my mind the image of a big hotel with lots of rooms. But this wouldn't be any ordinary travel lodge. This would be a place where heaven and earth meet. God's new creation as described in Revelation 21. But how do we get to this super premier inn run by Jesus? Thomas asks that very question in this passage. Lord, he says, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus replies, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And this tells us what being a living stone, a member of this royal priesthood, really means. It means to follow the way of Jesus. The way is the Jesus who washed the disciples' feet and told them to follow his example. The way is the Jesus who healed, who spoke of justice. The Jesus who said that the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God and to love one another, and even, controversially, to love your enemies. That's where the sacrifice really comes in. So at this time when we are sacrificing our normal life of fellowship and worship in our church buildings, meeting each week, for the sake and the health of the health and safety of us all, let's remember to be those living stones, building blocks of Christ's church, wherever we happen to be. Amen.
And now we come to our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. God, our Saviour, we pray for those who feel hopeless, that they may hear your good news and be freed from their anguish. We pray for those who have had their expectation of hope torn away, for those who feel discarded and deceived. We pray that the church will stand together with those who are suffering, working for acceptance and peace. We pray for those who are beginning to hope, those who dare to dream of a better tomorrow. We pray for all affected during this COVID-19 pandemic. We pray for those who are poor, sick, homeless, lonely, imprisoned, weighed down, or powerless. May your love reach them, and may we all stand together. May your church reach out to those in need, so that all may come to give thanks to you and celebrate together. Amen. And now we say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And now we sing together hymn number 690 from Singing the Faith, The Church's One Foundation. Worship at home this morning together, and we finish with a prayer of blessing. Let's pray. God the Father, by whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthen us to walk with him in his risen life, and may Almighty God bless us, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you, and see you next week.